A Musical Life with Yo-Yo Ma and the Silk Road Ensemble. World-renowned cellist Yo-Yo Ma established Silk Road in 1998 to explore how music can advance global understanding. Since 2000, the musicians of the world music collective Silk Road Ensemble have been on a mission to change the world by connecting diverse cultures and traditions in performances, workshops, and residencies. This episode of A Musical Life is brought to you by A Musical Life Mastermind. A Musical Life Mastermind is a place where I help musicians think outside the box and be inspired to change the world with their art. Drawing upon my own experiences as a classical pianist, co-founding a tech company, teaching hundreds of online music students, and hosting a podcast with over 300,000 downloads so far. Every week, we have live mastermind sessions, group video chats where we feature case studies and share ideas to help each other find more students, get more gigs, and explore creative ways to grow a career. If you're looking for a better way to make a living as a musician, I'd like to invite you to join the community at A Musical Life Mastermind. To get started with a free ebook on the number one resource you need to grow your music, visit AMusicalLifeMastermind.com. Once again, that web address is AMusicalLifeMastermind.com. Welcome to A Musical Life. I'm Hugh Sung. Yo-Yo Ma and the Grammy-nominated Silk Road Ensemble recently released their sixth album, Sing Me Home, which was developed and recorded alongside The Music of Strangers, a new documentary movie from Oscar and Emmy-winning director Morgan Neville that tells the story of the ensemble and Silk Road, its parent organization. The Music of Strangers is slated for theatrical release later this week and is one of the most breathtaking, beautiful, and moving documentaries I have ever seen. In this episode, we'll meet some of the remarkable musicians featured prominently in the film and listen to excerpts from Sing Me Home, an album which explores the musical roots of individual members of the ensemble. Let's start by listening to Going Home, sung in English and Chinese by Grammy-winning banjo player and singer Abigail Washburn and Silk Road Ensemble member Wu Tong.
Going My name is Wu Man. I play pipa.
Wu Man, thank you so much. I'm wondering if you could help our listeners understand what the pipa is. I think a lot of people may have never have heard of the instrument before.
We always describe a pipa as a lute-like plucking instrument with a pear-shaped. So it's old Chinese traditional instrument and existed in China around 2,000 years.
Wow. And it is spectacular how you make this instrument sound. What's also interesting is that the pipa, it looks like it sits on your lap rather mm-hmm. than being held like a lute or guitar that sort of hangs off to the side. Is that correct?
Yes, but pipa, as I mentioned, 2,000 years exist in China, and it gradually changed the way we play. Yeah, used to be, if you see old paintings, a long time ago at the Metropolitan Museum, there are a lot of figures, they're holding pipa very much like lute.
Or
wood, yeah. So, and then gradually we played with the hold of put on the lap with holding a string.
You are considered the greatest pipa player today and also a great pipa composer. Can you tell the story of how you came to be involved with Yo-Yo Ma's Silk Road Ensemble?
Oh, that's a long way. I remember 1998 when Yo-Yo first time we met. And that time I was living in Boston, so it's very close by. Some mutual friends introduced, and then Yo-Yo asked me if I interested in this project called Silk Road, which is crazy. I immediately say yes, because that's exactly to me exactly my goal too. I want the ancient Chinese pipa, this instrument, to be involved with others and also be able to introduce this instrument to the American audience. And this is the Silk Road. It's the great platform for me to sort of, east, west, whatever, the global music all together. But that was the first time, 1998.
In the documentary, the wonderful, wonderful documentary, it spends a lot of time exploring how you are so forward-thinking, not only to try to introduce the pipa instrument to Western audiences, but in all of your musical activities and even trying to help this wonderful group of puppeteers, these Chinese puppeteers that call themselves the first rock band of China, the ancient rock band of China. Wonderful musicians, wonderful artists. You seem to be so full of creativity that is very different from what a traditional pipa player might be trained to think. Where do you get that originality, that creative thinking?
I think that's it definitely, the experience, the open mind, that's my personality and the curiosity, that kind of part of me. But also, I think it's not like at the very beginning, I graduated from school and be a young musician. I have the idea. It's not like that. It's kind of gradually, what kind of people you work with, what musician you heard about it, and then also you travel travel in a different country, different culture you're faced to. So that kind of give me the encourage, give me the inspiration, basically. And the question I always ask myself, like, how, why, how can I introduce this, I always say, cool instrument and to outside of China. It's not only in Chinese community. Why not give to young generation to have another instrument to play, or give composer ideas.
Yes.
And for myself, at the same time, I could introduce this instrument, or also the Chinese culture, or would you say Asian culture, whatever, in the different culture to audience, say, hey, again, you know, we're not only European music here. We have global music. We have so many other traditions exist much longer history. So that's kind of for me, encouraging me to work very hard. I can't help it. I don't know. Just, it's me.
It's wonderful. The very first scene of you in the documentary is actually you playing an electric. Is that electric pipa? Is that like electric guitar?
Yeah, it's electric pipa.
is that common? Is that easily found nowadays?
And it's getting some, you know, some younger generation, they play pop music. They start to build electric pipa. I say called e-pipa. But it's not in the tradition, definitely. It's not common. But I think in the future, probably there will be very successful e-pipa.
That was very, very cool. And you look like you're having so much fun playing that.
Especially in the guitar shop.
Yeah. I'm curious, because the pipa is so old, there must be a different music notation, a Chinese music notation for reading music. Is that correct?
Yes, you're absolutely right. Chinese notation, there are different Chinese notation. The early Chinese notation, I'm talking about maybe 8th century, 9th century, it's what's called that it's actually all words. There is no notation. It's a tablature.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. And it's always, it's described like a poetry. It's described like which finger, which string, which note, how long. So kind of you have to interpret to the notes. And mostly lately we have a notation, which is a number system.
Oh,
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Mm. I heard it very much like a Japanese shakuhachi notation.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Did you learn Western notation while you were studying the pipa, or did you have to learn that afterwards?
I started with the Chinese notation, and when I went to music school in Beijing, and we all have to learn Western notation.
So there was no difficulty when you joined the Silk Road Ensemble to write compositions that other instrumentalists could also collaborate with you on. Is that correct?
Yes. I read both notation.
Now, do you teach your notation to them? Do they have to learn your notation as well?
No. It will be very confused to them.
Might be a good lesson, though. I mean,
that would be good math.
Yes. I'm wondering if you could spend some time talking a little bit about your wonderful composition, which starts the album, Sing Me Home, which is the companion album to the documentary. It's called Vincent's Tune. And can you tell us how that came about? This is a wonderful track that starts the whole album off.
That's chaos, crazy. But also very powerful opening.
Yes.
So I have the title Green, Vincent's Tune. Why I put Vincent's, because Vincent's my son's name. As I in the program notes, I mentioned when he was 4 years old, he always sing those strange tune at home, running around. So I was very curious. I asked him, like, where you heard this? How? And he said, I made up, Mom.
What?
So I thought it was so cute. I have to document it. I have to record it. So I sneak in his room when he was playing, singing, and I just use the recording, record that tune. That kind of children's voice. And then I made a piece for so-called ensemble, a suite, which is green and red and blue, kind of color piece. And then, so this time for this particular album, we have a much stronger team. I like the color of green. To me, green, it's growing, it's changing. And it's a start over again. It's happy, you know, everything, it's springtime. And also childish. So everything kind of combined together, combination. And so you hear the tune is there, play on the pipa. Dee-dee-da-da, dee-dee-da, pipa solo on the top. And then added the strings and a voice, and I want to have Beijing opera kind of style.
Wow.
And the percussion, the gong, but also the beautiful, beautiful voice in this particular track was amazing addition to this track. So, of course, a lot of musicians, all the musicians, and they contributed their own style, their own fantastic talent.
That's what makes the ensemble so remarkable, this blend of so many styles, traditions, abilities, and creativity.
Yes.
Your son must have been so excited when he heard your composition of his melody.
Yeah, well, at the first time he heard, he was very embarrassed.
Oh!
He said, why, Mom, why you put my name there? You know, I said, well, this album is about home.
Yes.
I said that you are part of, to me, children, that's also, that's a home, you know, parents, children. So I said that it's also a gift to your generation.
It's interesting because in the documentary, you point out some interesting paradoxes where you are Chinese mm-hmm. in America and you feel, you know, displaced. And yet when you go to China, they don't look at you as being Chinese anymore because you have been in the United States. And so the whole idea of home, it's strange because it doesn't always mean location like we're used to thinking.
Right.
And so the fact that you look to your son as a definition of home seems to be very significant.
Exactly. Thank you.
Hey, my name is Johnny Gandelsman. I play violin and live in New York. I play with a string quartet called Brooklyn Rider and a world music collective called the Silk Road Ensemble.
How did you get involved with the Silk Road Ensemble? And how long have you been with them?
I've been with the group. My first time with Silk Road was in 2002. When I filled in for a friend of mine who also plays violin, Colin Jacobson, who was a member from the very beginning, from the year 2000. And the group was at the Smithsonian Folklife Festival in D.C. Colin couldn't be there for the whole time and asked me to step in, and that was kind of the beginning. So it's been almost... almost 15 years.
That's incredible. Now, 15 years later, we're now looking at the sixth album that Silk Road Ensemble has produced, which was just released, called Sing Me Home, which you are actually credited as being one of the producers. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Tell me, what does a producer actually do?
Oh, well, I don't know if it's as glamorous as it sounds. A lot of it has to do with, you know, what kind of food we want to provide for lunch and dinner for all the musicians, but... I mean, it's a nice process. You know, we developed a track list, you know, so choosing the material for the album. And then this album is very special because each track has a guest joining us. And so, you know, figuring out which guests to invite and matching them to the material and just, you know, working through the arrangements and, you know, booking studios. And it's a lot of stuff. A lot of logistics. But it's really fun because it's a nice responsibility to have. The ensemble really wanted to have an album that would dive in deeply into the talents of individual members of the group. And so a lot of the tracks are either written by or arranged by members of the ensemble. And they kind of bring, you know, a focus onto individual lives and passions of ensemble members. Mm.
Let's talk a little bit about the track called Madhushi. Is that how it's pronounced?
Madhushi.
Madhushi. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And this was initiated by a collaboration between Kehan Kalhor and Sandeep Das. And Kehan is featured quite prominently mm-hmm. in the new movie that's coming out about you. And his story is profound and very, very moving. But I'm wondering if you could help our listeners understand who Kehan is, what he plays,
sure.
his musicianship and his life are just both remarkable. And then we can talk a little bit about this track.
Sure. Well, Kehan Kalhor plays the kemanche, which is a Persian spike fiddle. And which Yo-Yo often says that it's the great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather of the cello.
Because they're played almost in a similar fashion. He doesn't tuck the fiddle under his chin.
Right.
He has
a spike that goes into the floor or his knee, and then it's a beautiful, an incredibly beautiful four-string instrument.
And he has a bow.
Bow that he draws across, and he's one of the world's greatest
yes.
musicians of any styles. And yes, his story, you really should see the film to get the full story, but he is of Kurdish descent from Iran, with a lot of tragedy that has happened in his life, and he's left Iran when he was a young man and immigrated multiple times. He lived in Italy, he lived in Canada, he lived here in Brooklyn, New York, just a few blocks from where my son now goes to school. And you know, along the way, he's been pushing his tradition forward, which is really beautiful. I mean, he comes from, you know, Persian classical music. There's, again, hundreds of years of tradition. And but Kehan, like many musicians in the ensemble, look at collaboration outside of their tradition as one of great ways to innovate. And so one of the projects that he's been doing for many years is this trio that he had was a fantastic sitar player and singer from India, Shujat Khan, and a tabla player from India
named Sandeep Das. Let's talk about what the tabla is.
Tabla is a set of drums, two drums, left and right. A low drum and a high drum, and they're called speaking drums. And again, Sandeep is one of the true masters of this instrument. And so the three of them have toured together many years, and they perform. Their style of music is rooted in improvisation, and what's really nice, they haven't played together for a few years, and then this past year they went on tour again, and it just so happened that they were going to be in New York on a day that we were going to record something, and two musicians from Silk Road Ensemble joined them, Colin Jacobson, violinist, and a wonderful cellist who does a lot of improvisation on his own, named Mike Block. And together they created this track called Madushi, which is, it's the longest track on the album. It's about 9 minutes. But it's also one of the most moving tracks, I think, of our ensemble's history. It's absolutely gorgeous. I'm really excited about it.
My name is Cristina Pato, and I play the Galician bagpipes, the Gaita Galega, which is a kind of bagpipe from the northwest corner of Spain, in Galicia. I live in New York, and I have been devoting my life into switch from classical music to world music, and I some sort kind of found a home in the Silk Road Ensemble with Yo-Yo Ma.
Kind of found a home? That sounds so ambivalent. It sounds like you're ready to pack up and leave at any moment.
Well, this is pretty much the life of any musician, right? And I still have, that's the beauty of this ensemble too, the Silk Road Ensemble, the fact that each one of us have many different musical lives, and we keep those lives alive, and then we come back to the ensemble with what we are learning from other musicians. So yes, I kind of have a home with Silk Road, but I also have my own quartet, my solo career, a lot of collaborations with many different other musical languages that I will not even there about living without all those connections, because that's what feed my soul.
It sounds like this is the new normal for the musicians of tomorrow. The musicians of yesterday perhaps dreamed of having one job. They would be in an orchestra, teach at a school, and that's it. But the musicians of today sounds like this is almost necessary to have multiple homes, multiple worlds to explore. Do you find that to be the case?
I do find it mostly also because I have been focused in an instrument that doesn't have an actual path. I cannot find a job in a university or in an orchestra. I play bagpipes, and it sounds like a joke, but that's the reality. A bagpipe doesn't have a path to follow. So in the process of having to invent my own path as a bagpiper, I discovered that my other life as a classical pianist would be also more meaningful if I was exploring other fields and other professions too. So at the end, in the 21st century, I'm 35 years old, and I've been dealing with business and economics and the politics of this business and everything that is around it for more than 20 years since I became a professional musician. And if somebody had taught me in musical school something about running a business and something about speaking to the public media and a little bit about web design and a little bit about this and about that, probably my career would have been a little bit easier. And on the other hand, you learn by doing. So the more you do, the more you learn, and the more you are aware about how powerful it is that you can actually do so many things at once. And you are right. I mean, it's the only way to survive, and I am happy to have decided to choose the difficult path as opposed to the easy one.
Let's talk a little bit about how you got involved with the Silk Road Ensemble. It's a wonderful quote in the movie where composer Osvaldo Golijov says that, Cristina, you bring something so sensual, so earthy, something, and Johnny is going, you have to get this person. She's a rock star on the bagpipes. Apparently you brought something really vital to Silk Road Ensemble. Can you tell us the story of how you came to be involved with this new family?
It's actually connected to what we were just talking about. I moved to the US 11 years ago to get my doctorate in collaborative piano. And collaborative piano, for those listeners that do not know about that field, which I didn't even know about that field until I moved to the US.
Oh, really?
No, just kidding. But I have been a chamber music pianist all my life. And collaborative pianists are usually the ones that are playing with singers and do chamber music. And that means you have to learn a lot of repertory, a lot of many different languages, and learn how to work with people in a very meaningful way. And Osvaldo Golijov came to the school I was doing my doctorate at Rutgers University in New Jersey, and he was giving a masterclass, and I was supposed to be coaching the singer that was going to be singing one of his tunes, because that tune was in Galician.
Ah.
How random, right?
Yeah.
And we met that day, and then he discovered I had another life in Spain as a bagpiper, and then he discovered that wild side of me. And one day he said, why don't you and your husband come to where we are? We are here in Lenox, Massachusetts with a bunch of friends. Bring your instruments and yeah, I just want them to meet you. This was around Tanglewood, around one of these Silk Road Ensemble workshops that they were doing in the home of Boston Symphony in the Tanglewood, Massachusetts. And I brought a manchego cheese, I brought my bagpipes, and when I arrived there, I realized that I was meeting all these amazing musicians that I have been admiring for so many time. But on the other hand, I play bagpipes, so I didn't have any kind of expectation of, you know, like, I'm here just to show my instrument and the possibilities of what I do, but that's it. You know, when you don't have that kind of need of showing somebody what you can do to be there for the next time, in my case, it was quite the opposite. It was about how exciting this is that I am getting to share the Galician bagpipe with all of you. And little I knew that the week after that, I was performing with them in Carnegie Hall.
Oh my goodness.
And then the whole journey, a journey that has changed my life, began right after that.
Tell us a little bit about these workshops, if you don't mind. I know the film talks about the early days when the ensemble began at Tanglewood with these workshops. What exactly happened? And you were invited, you brought your instrument. Would classical musicians be in attendance? Or what exactly was the goal of these workshops?
I cannot even imagine how was the first one in 2000, the one that actually made this project begin.
Yeah.
Because that has had been probably a very, very crazy situation in every way, because we were talking about many different languages, people that was coming from Mongolia, from Persia, from China, from Japan, and some of those members are still very active parts of the ensemble, like Kehan, Bouton, or Woman, or Colin Jacobsen or Nick Kors, that were part of that beginning ensemble. When I joined in, it was actually the summer of 2006, and it was very organic. I arrived there and I meet this family of musicians, new and old ones, because what they do is usually they gather composers and musicians to work together in different pieces, and they workshop them for a couple of weeks. So it's not about the quality of the musicianship of somebody, it's about the quality of the person and the way of sharing and the generosity and the curiosity about it. And when I arrived there and I played a little bit, then Johnny, I remember perfectly, Johnny picked up his instrument and he started like accompanying a Galician dance, and Jeffrey Beecher on the bass was also doing that. And then I see Kehan with his face on the floor looking at me like, what is that? And then you create a beautiful sense of family is created in there in a way that you cannot even explain with words. And that is what you can hear when you listen to the album, Sing Me Home, or when you watch the movie, The Music of Strangers, is this familiarity that makes you be inside of that person's world in just 1 second.
And comfortable to improvise together, even though you come from completely different styles.
Well, that's the JoJo thing, you know, like JoJo creates this space of trust and generosity that gives us a way for trying things without having to explain what are those things about, without having to say, well, no, the Galician Bapa cannot do this. No, you just try. And if it works, it works. If not, well, try another thing.
Mm. Many of the young people who train in the classical arts are very fearful. They fear mistakes. They work so hard to be perfect, performance fears, stage anxiety. there's no freedom, really. They're just trained to play in a certain way. What advice do you have to help people be more earthy, be more sensual, to find that excitement that you bring, that freshness that you bring to your music? Where do you discover that? Because I think you also faced some criticism for your new way of thinking of the bagpipes from your own country too, didn't you?
I mean, criticism is going to be always there, and that's always a question of taste. And I will say that I'm 35 years old, and I have been looking for what I want to say for 35 years. And in that process of looking, then you discover different ways of saying the things you thought you could say only one way. I was trained in classical music too, and sadly that doesn't change no matter in which country you are in the world. And it's this mixture between athletics and music what makes it so unique. But on the other hand, the discipline you have on classical music is something you can use really nicely in other musical disciplines. And the freedom you have in the other disciplines is also because the other musical languages are languages for the community, are languages for people, in my own case, the Galician bagpipe, for people to dance, for people to gather around, for parties, for weddings, for funerals, are meant to be to create a very specific state of mind and a state of space. And I try to do that when I sit on the piano too, and I try to find what is what I have that makes me different from a person that plays the same instrument. And finding that true voice that changes with time is probably the only advice I would dare to share with people, because that's the hardest thing to do, to stay true to yourself and also let yourself grow in the process of staying true.
I know the movie deals with this subject a good deal. The difficulty, the challenges of memory, of being true to a tradition, being true to a culture, and yet finding ways to make it evolve, to help it to grow so it doesn't simply stay in the past.
Because it also dies if it stays in the past, you know, And when you come from a country in which millions of people are playing a specific instrument, the probability of that instrument's tradition to die is lower than when you come from a place in which nobody even knows where it is in the map. Galicia, by the way, is in the northwest corner of Spain. But we are 3 million people, you know, and although most of us play bagpipes, outside of Galicia, playing a bagpipe is not relevant. And how do you make it relevant? How do you make it important? And how do you share the excitement you have with your community with other people? And music covers that in such a powerful way.
I'd like to spend a moment talking about your contribution. Well, you're contributing to the whole album, but in the album Sing Me Home, which is the companion album to the movie, you have a track called Cabellinho. I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about this.
So in this beautiful family, you try to invite more friends into making your former family, right? In my case, the Galician people. And Johnny Gandesman, who co-produced this album, heard my previous album with Galician musicians, Rustica, David Salvado on the voice, and Sancho Pintos on the zanfona, which is a kind of Galician hardy-gardy, and my accordion player in Galicia, Roberto Comesaña. And he thought that it would be interesting to actually have them as guests in this album. And to me, it was even more meaningful because Rustica, the project that we called ourselves, is also a way of connecting four artists that usually have nothing to do with each other. I mean, I used to focus more in pop and rock in my career in Galicia. Davide is more like a traditional musician. Ancho Pintos on the hardy-gardy has a beautiful way of understanding folk music. And the accordion player Roberto is a jazz musician. So putting the four of us together to do an album on Galician music was what led us into being part of this album too. And the singer, David Salvado, he has his own horses in Galicia, and he lives in the middle of the rural areas of Galicia. And somehow his way of being reminds me a lot to Kehan, who also is a lover of horses, yes, and a person that appreciates nature in that way. So Cavallino is about, is literally little horse, and it's a song about the horse and the relationship of the horse and the person that uses the horse as a work instrument, and how deep that relationship it is. And the fact of having Kehan playing on a Galician tune, and the fact that it actually sounds really, really beautiful and really connected and organic, that you cannot even think that you are listening to a Galician singer playing with a Persian Comanche player. And that to me is the meaning of this poem.
Meu cavalinho, cavalo, meu cavalinho redondo, y eché de corta las pernas, se tú me levas no lombo, veré la
My name is Kinan Azmi. I'm a clarinetist and a composer, member of the Silk Road Ensemble.
Kinan, can you tell me, how did you get involved with the Silk Road Ensemble?
There are two sides for that. I was mentally involved or emotionally involved since the beginning. This is when I was still in Syria. This is the year 2000. And I heard about the ensemble. And for me, it was something, and of course, you know, Yo-Yo is one of my heroes for, you know, throughout eternity. And I heard about the ensemble, and I always thought, I was always thinking in a similar fashion in terms of what music is and what do I do in music. And you know, I'm from Damascus, Syria. I play Western classical instrument and Western classical music. I moved to New York in 2001, and I met a number of actually of the ensemble members throughout, you know, my active life as a musician here in New York. And then when I was approached in about 4 years ago now, if I wanted to join the ensemble. So for me, it was a natural evolution of things, if you want. And so I was invited. David Bruce, a British composer, wrote a piece that invited a clarinet player, and the ensemble member thought of me. and the rest is history, as they say.
That's wonderful. Now, I may be mistaken, but the clarinet is not a typical Syrian instrument, is it?
It's not at all.
Okay.
For some very peculiar reason, you know, clarinet was invented and developed somewhere between France, Germany, and Russia.
Yes.
And I'm talking about the clarinet as we know it now. And it traveled, you know, around the world quite a lot, across the Atlantic, of course, to the Americas, but also it traveled east as far as Turkey. But it never went south of Turkey for some reason. The Arabic traditional ensemble that is called the Taht never had the clarinet. There is a few Arab composers, Muhammad Abdul Wahab is one of them, who actually started to westernize the traditional Arabic ensemble by inviting saxophones and clarinets and oboes and so on. But the clarinet never had an appearance in Arabic classical music. While it's, you know, the predominant instrument in Turkish music or in music in Azerbaijan or in Armenia. But I think, you know, the way I think about it is it doesn't matter what you play. You know, I think you have to have three things. You have to have an instrument, whether it's your voice or something that can be your voice. You have to have the skills to use that tool to be able to express what you have in mind. You have to have something in mind to say, I think. In that matter, it doesn't matter, I think, what instrument you play.
And I was overhearing a little bit of another interview that you were doing where I understand that your father loved Western classical music, but your mother loved Arabic music. So you had that mixture at home, but you really, it wasn't until you came to the United States that you really started to explore more of your Arabic musical roots. Is that correct?
I think that's when the like digging in like vertically started. I was always interested horizontally in kind of finding where things are. I mean, back home, I studied Western classical music. But I heard lots of Arabic music. I mean, mind you, Damascus or Syria, you know, in general, is a very cosmopolitan place. You know, there are lots of traditions that coexist in that city. You know, it's not only Arabic music. There's Arabic music, there's Kurdish music, there's Armenian, there's Syriac. There are lots of influences that exist in Syria, in what we call now Arabic music, but it's lots of other influences. And you hear that a lot, you know, walking the streets, and you hear the calling for the prayers, and you hear, the, you know, the ancient Syriac chants in the churches. So all of that, I had that in my, you know, in the back of my mind somewhere. But it's only when I came here that I decided to actually dig vertically, as I explained it. And that's when I started actually one of my ensembles, just to fulfill that need.
You made a very interesting observation in the movie, where, as you just described, many people here in the West think of the Middle East as very, very isolated. But it is actually a very cosmopolitan blend of so many cultures, isn't it? We don't even realize that here in the West many times.
I mean, I think I have a problem also with, you know, when we say East and West.
Yes,
I mean, East of what and East of
what? Yeah, that's a very good point.
I mean, like the music that I write or I play, and lots of the time has been described as music from the East. Mm. You know, when I play in the US or I play in Europe, oh, he's coming from the East. He plays Eastern sound.
Yeah.
But what happens if I take my music to Japan? Do I become suddenly the music of the West only because Syria happens to be to the West of Japan? So that categorization, I think, only helps in archiving or, you know, just to have the access. But I think it's misleading in a way. And so I don't really believe in these geographical separations or boundaries. And when we think about the Middle East, like if you think about like a colonial division, like, okay, it's the Middle East because we are halfway according to the British colonizers, for example, So I'm trying to avoid these terms. And the Middle East, you know, as I described, Syria, for example, is like a cosmopol of lots of cultures. Mm. You know, we are part of the Silk Road as well. And the trading routes, many of them pass by the Middle East. Whether it's Armenian, Kurdish, Syriac, you can even hear Aramaic now, ancient Aramaic in Syria.
Wow.
It's still alive.
Mm. The language of Christ.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And, you know, in addition to Arabic. Mm. So it is already a combination of very rich cultures that coexisted and interacted with each other. So the way media looks at the Middle East as, okay, these are the people from the Middle East. They fight and they, you know, of course it serves a certain goal, but it's certainly not accurate.
Yes. In the movie, there were many transparent, very painful moments that they captured on film with your reactions and your frustrations, even given the political turmoil, the violence in that region of the world. And the questions I was hearing from you was, why bother? Why be a musician? You know, what purpose does music even serve in the light of such horrific tragedies, you know, the atrocities that people can do to each other? How, you know, there's a line that is in the trailer, how can music stop a bullet? I mean, that sounds all very fanciful, but you know, we have to live in the real world. Mm-hmm. We can't speak on platitudes. I mean, I'm wondering if you could speak to that sense of despair and frustration that you felt, and maybe even still wrestle with today. As why be a musician when there maybe, you know, would it be better to be a doctor? Would it be better to be an engineer? Would it be better to do something else?
I mean, I did struggle with that, especially in the first year after the Syrian revolution started, and it was met with bullets. Yes. And you question immediately, what is the best role that I can play right now?
Yeah.
And your immediate reaction is, you know, I want to be a doctor. You want to be somebody who's helping on the ground in a concrete way. Yeah. But then it takes you also a while to realize, I'm trained to do something. And my biggest capital actually is what I know, the skills. You know, I'm talking about the, you know, the ideas you have and the skills to express what you can express. And it will be, I didn't want to lose that. You know, I have something, all these years of training, I think this is the time to use it.
But how?
More than anything else. Yeah. And then you realize the limitation of what you do, right? It does sound fanciful, yes. You play and what, does it stop a bullet? It doesn't. Does it do anything? It doesn't. But what I realize it does is it gives you the opportunity to inspire people to be more proactive. And if you think of the Syrian revolution and the popular uprising as a moment when people of Syria wanted to speak up and wanted to express themselves, that's at the core of why the whole thing began. I have the luxury of having an instrument that I can express myself. So I think I want to practice that, right? You know, the fact that music making is an act of freedom, you know, if you think about it this way, I wanted to practice that.
Yeah.
Because by practicing it, you're hoping that it's contagious and it maybe invites other people to speak up too. And also sometimes you can use music in a more concrete way, whether you're playing in a refugee camp or whether you're doing a fundraising event to help in a concrete way, bringing medical aid or educational aid, whatever you want. That has effects. But the music itself as sound waves, you know, I think it can invite people to reflect, to think, which is, I think, is a good act too. You know, to think and reflect and really be inspired. When I play in, you know, I just came back from Beirut, for example. And Beirut has lots of Syrians who were, you know, moved away from Syria and living in Beirut.
Yes.
And when I play, if one person in this in that hall was inspired to forget a little bit or to find some kind of healing in the music, then I have achieved something, you know.
There is a beautiful section in the film that documents one of your trips to one of the refugee camps in Jordan. And I was reading a little bit about the making of the film. It was very difficult to get security clearance to do that. And in this section, you're smuggling flutes to give to the children there. And it shows you conducting these beautiful workshops with your friend who's the visual artist. You're playing, he's illustrating what you're playing, and you ask the children, what do they see? What do they feel? And then you're handing these musical instruments out to the children. And as we were sitting, getting ready to sit down and do this interview, we were reflecting a little bit. You know, you had made a comment that nobody cares. It's just news. These are just refugees stuck in the middle of nowhere. But you did something so beautiful. You could have maybe raised money to send clothes. You could have, you know, maybe raised money to send food, medicine. You gave them musical instruments. Those musical instruments are given to human beings. Humans only have that capacity for creative expression. And you helped us to see these beautiful children, these beautiful people. They're human brothers and sisters like we are. And that was, were you thinking along those lines? Helping us define these nameless faces, so to speak, by that act of music.
You know, I smuggled flutes and other instruments like a number of times. I hope like I'm not going to be condemned for actually admitting that on microphone.
I'm sure there are far worse things to be smuggling.
I know, of course. No, but the thing is, because for me, it was all about, I want to communicate with these kids as partners. Yes. I mean, that for me was the most important. You know, I am going there with my clarinet, so might as well, I want them to have the experience that I had, you know, which is what does it mean to you to play an instrument? You know, what does it provide to you? Like we talked earlier, shelter and food, it's given to all beings, yes, right? Yeah. But music is, it's not limited to only humans, but true, in a way,
yeah,
it is. And it's incredible what it does. You know, the fact that we're sitting together, writing songs together and trying to learn how to play a few notes. I mean, we didn't spend a long time. But to produce a sound is an incredible act of, it's a proactive event, you know, yes, to produce a sound out of a piece of plastic,
yeah,
you know, or out of a piece of a wooden metal like the clarinet is. And for me to work with them, it was me trying to, like, let's play together versus me, okay, do this and do that and do your homework. You know, it was just to go and play with them. For me, I hope it offered them something, you know, at least something that they might continue doing. But also it offered me an incredible amount of inspiration. I mean, to see how resilient they are. I mean, we're sitting in that tent, well, bigger tent. And I think in the film it was actually in an urban refugee center. you know, these kids in that moment, we were just partners playing music and singing songs. And for me, I was going back, you know, I'm going to go back to a place where I have a home, right?
Yeah.
But for most of them, they don't.
Yeah.
And it's very important for me to remember that.
Mm.
The frustration comes from different angles. I mean, I'm still now frustrated. I mean, you know, sure, like yesterday, it's been a week that Aleppo has been bombed, like mercilessly, you know, including hospitals and everything. And people are still negotiating whether a ceasefire in Aleppo should be imposed or not. I mean, it drives me crazy.
Mm.
But in the meantime, for me not to go crazy, I continue to play music, and I continue to think that everybody deserves the pleasure of music.
Mm.
Pleasure in the most positive sense,
yes, yes,
not in the shallow sense. Yes. I think music offers us a combination of mixed emotions that are beyond what we can express in words. And I will just continue to do so.
I'd like to talk a little bit about the track that you contributed to Sing Me Home, the album that is a companion to this wonderful movie. I understand that this is dedicated to all the Syrians that have fallen in love in the past 5 years, the joys and the challenges, the trials. Can you describe this track for us and what you were trying to convey through this?
I mean, the track was written, it's an older piece of mine, I think from 2007.
Mm.
And for me, the piece was about to capture what the mood one can find in a Syrian wedding village, in a Syrian village wedding. Usually, these village weddings take place in the public square for everybody to attend. You cannot disinvite anybody, and the host families are expected to feed everybody in the village.
Oh my!
And that shapes the musical direction of the wedding party, because people show up, they have different songs in their minds, different communities have different, sometimes different languages or different accents, different musical instruments, and they all come and contribute, right? They play, and so everything goes, basically, right? And for me, the piece became more meaningful, I mean, the past 5 years, I guess like everything else, because I still see people falling in love, and it's amazing, it's quite inspiring to see that there are people under like the barrel bombs and all these bullets, people manage still to fall in love.
Mm.
And for me, it's important to know or to remember that falling in love is one of the few basic rights that no dictatorship can take away from you.
Yeah.
You know, it's some kind of resistance too.
Mm.
Just to fall in love, the simple act of falling in love. Actually, if you think of what Syria has produced artistically in the last 5 years under all these circumstances, whether art in Syria or, in the other communities where people fled to, there are lots of not only art about the revolution and the tragedy, there are love stories that are coming in terms of novels, and there are love poems, and there are films about nature, and I think it's nice to see that the society actually is still able to practice that very simple task of falling in love. Within all of this, it's quite amazing for me to see.
Yo-Yo, thank you so much for being on the show.
Yeah, it's great to be with you. You're such a genius.
You're the genius.
This is amazing. I see you one day in Philadelphia. You're reading, Score of Shlomo on the piano. And then the next thing I see you, it's like, the iPad with the pedal. You invented that. And now you're doing podcasts. Where am I going to see you next?
Well, who knows? Maybe something creative. We'll see. But
and you hacked Panama.
There you go. That's right.
My goodness.
I was actually going to talk to you a little bit about that time that we met when I was playing for a friend of mine. We were playing Shlomo. The thing that really struck me, this was a private lesson, but rather than talk about how to play the piece, what really struck me is that you focused on why. Why play the piece? Why the notes are written? Why would the composer do this? Why play it a certain way? What's the motive? You were looking at the DNA of the music, and as I was watching this wonderful film, When Strangers Meet, that talks about your journey, both with the Silk Road Ensemble, but also personally as a musician, it seems like that was the central question. Why? Why play music? Why be a musician? What does what we do contribute to the world in a meaningful way beyond just simply having a name or a career?
Well, I think those are the perpetual questions, and you could have momentary answers, but you never stop asking. And it's the same question a two-year-old asks their parents. Why, Daddy? Why? Because they know it's good at some point. First of all, you'll get answers for a while.
Yeah. At some That's point, not, it's
it becomes
not
incredibly
enough.
Irritating. So, the question is, why am I doing that? Yeah. Is it to be irritating? Or to try and get some answers? Yeah. I think purpose is, purposeful living, meaningful living, is actually probably the most human of qualities. It's not survival. Survival is, everything is survival, right? Any living thing strives to survive and tries to find a balance in conditions so that where survival is possible. But beyond that, it is, we have a consciousness, we have memory, we have collective memory, we have memory beyond our own lifetime.
Yes.
And so, and I think where the arts and sciences contribute to that is that culture works in blocks. You do something, the block is discernible, but it's constructive when someone else can build on it. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
So, you know, we stand on Bach's shoulders because Bach actually figured out so many things that we're still trying to kind of get beyond. Newton said he, you know, stands on the shoulders of giants. And so in science, if you have a building block of something because you know that you can prove something, it can be replicable, so someone else can build on it. And so what we build ultimately is our humanity. Mm-hmm. Right? So machines can do things better, more quickly, more efficiently, can go to more dangerous areas and can go to places where we can't go. But we have the responsibility of trying to be the best humans that we can.
Mm. And you also speak in the movie about these concentric circles or these overlapping circles of culture. And that intersection is where a lot of creativity is fostered or birthed. Even I'm wondering if that applies not just to cultural artistic, but also sciences and all the aspects.
Absolutely,
of human
all
life.
Inventions. Yeah. It's all, you know. It's. I think creativity does happen at the margins, mm. and yet the margins are the part of society that's not in the center. Mm. So it's how well the center communicates with the margins and vice versa mm. that actually makes for a thriving, evolving society. I think not to have that is like sort of cutting out your supply line to the scouts mm. that bring you information from the edge that could be really useful to ward off cliffs, whether fiscal or otherwise.
Yeah, yeah.
And we need scouts. Mm. Scientists are our scouts. Mm. Artists, by having certain sensitivities and getting the vibe of things, you know, at the edge, can say, you know, something is happening. We have this feeling. It's not good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of people knew World War I was coming, going to happen. They didn't know how it was going to happen, but it was in the air. So we actually need, and we need to diffuse things whenever possible, which means you actually have to be able to get to the center.
Mm-hmm.
You know, 9/11, right? Yeah. We knew some of the information, but it didn't connect to the center.
Yeah.
Either the center wasn't listening, or people weren't trusted enough to get to the center, but whatever. So people know things. Mm. Everybody knows things.
Sure.
How are we actually asking people mm. what they know?
Mm.
You know? And it's about listening. It's about paying attention.
Mm. And this is where music can really inform not just other musicians, but everyone.
Right.
Teaching them to listen.
Absolutely. Yeah. Because I think when you're really involved using all your senses, and music certainly, you know, is a physical thing, it's a mental thing, it's an emotional thing, it's a you know, you use your critical thinking, mm. as you know so well. And when you're using everything that you have, when you're using 100% of yourself, you're actually most aware.
Yo-Yo, thank you so much for being on the show.
It's great that you're doing this podcast. It's
thank
fantastic.
You. Thank you. Thank
it's
you
wonderful
so much.
To see you.
Thank you. see my baby there. She was lying on a long wooden table, so cold, so still, so fair.
Johnny, this album goes around the world and highlights the unique ethnic makeups of all the members of your ensemble. And yet there's also a lovely return home to the United States. And the last track, Heart and Soul, was it's kind of a nice surprise, mm-hmm. you know? Something that so many people, when they're first learning to play the piano, they mess around with that. And you guys give it an incredibly unique twist. Tell us about this. I think it's wonderful that, you know, as we go around the world, there's still something here in the United States that absolutely. Is wonderful to contribute to the album.
Well, and the you know, the funny thing is that it is an American tune, of course, but it's as you say, you know, it's a tune that is known literally, you know, by millions of kids and people who love to play the piano around the world. So it is, in a way, a global track.
Yeah.
And the first time I heard it was when my family moved to Israel when I was 12 years old. And my very first day at school, I was in seventh grade, there was a upright piano. And when I walked into the class, this was before the first, you know, subject was happening, before anybody said hello, there was a ton of kids that surrounded this upright piano, and they were banging out this tune, you know, like, and I had no idea what it was, but I just then when I was thinking about the album, thinking about you know, what are we missing, I was in a hotel room somewhere in the Midwest, and the movie Big was on, and of course you know,
yeah.
you know that scene when Tom Hanks is dancing on the, you know, what do you call that?
The giant.
The floor piano, you know, and he's playing that song, and I thought, oh my God, wouldn't it be fun to do that? Because it's so, you know, there's so much joy in that tune, and you know, then I went online and found out that the tune has a bridge, you know,
which nobody knows. And you know, I have to confess, I don't think I've ever heard the lyrics before.
Right.
I've only heard the tune. I've never heard the words.
Right. Yeah. But it's such a beautiful, you know, classic Hollywood song from the 30s. And so I'm really glad that we were able to do it. And of course, the singers that join us for this track, Gregory Porter, one of the leading jazz singers of today, and then Lisa Fisher, who is, you know, an incredible singer who has sang with some of the world's greatest pop and rock stars, and some people may not know her because she mostly does backup singing, but they will recognize her on tracks of, you know, Rolling Stones and Sting and people like that. And she was one of the subjects of the wonderful documentary 20 Feet from Stardom from a couple of years ago. And so Lisa and Gregory together as a duet, it was really wonderful.
What a wonderful way to end the album.
Yeah.
So I fell in love with you, heart and soul, the way a fool would do, madly, because you held me tight and stole a kiss in the night. Heart and soul, I beg to be adored, lost control, and tumbled overboard gladly. That magic night we kissed
there in the moonlight.
Oh, but your lips are thrilling, much too thrilling.
Never before were I so strangely willing.
Now I see what one embrace can do. Look at me.
Ooh, yeah.
It's got me loving you. You stole, held on my heart and soul.
For links to the Silk Road Project website, as well as information on the upcoming documentary, The Music of Strangers, and the album, Sing Me Home, visit the show notes at amusicallife.com. Special thanks to Sony Music Masterworks and NPR's New York Bureau for making this episode possible. If you enjoy these stories about making music and the things that move our souls, please support this podcast by telling a friend and posting a short review on iTunes at amusicallife.com/review. Thank you. Until next time, I'm Hugh Sung, and I wish you a musical life.